Hi, let's talk about the fascia associated with the pharynx and the retropharyngeal space. In this video, we'll talk about the various fasciae associated with the pharynx, and we'll describe the boundaries and divisions of the retropharyngeal space and discuss any clinical correlations. So we're looking here at a transverse section of the neck. Here is anterior. Here is posterior. We can see from the orientation of this particular cervical vertebrae the various neck muscles and viscera and compartments within the neck. So just to give us some further orientation of viscera, etc. There's our trachea. There is our esophagus. And we can see the thyroid gland wrapped about there. Here are some of those infrahyoid muscles. There's SCM on either side. And then there's trapezius. And then wrapping around here are the carotid sheaths. So in other videos, there was a discussion of the various layers of the cervical fascia, etc. And I really want us to focus here on some of the particulars of the deep cervical fascia. And we'll call into play some of the middle layers of the deep cervical fascia, as well as the deep layers of the deep cervical fascia, so that that we can begin to understand the particulars of the fascial spaces that they prescribe. Now, fascial spaces generally, not always, but generally are potential spaces. So they're layered upon one another and other features, and from time to time, infections can spread, various tissues can metastasize into these spaces, anesthetic agents when injected into a potential space can spread, even air, as we can see, can move in a potential space, and I've even published on this. So to get to the particulars of what I'd like to discuss, so this blue layer here, this light blue layer, just outline it. This is the buccopharyngeal fascia. That buccopharyngeal fascia is going to be found on the posterior aspect here of the esophagus, and it's going to be the investing fascia of the posterior and lateral walls of the pharyngeal constrictor muscles, as we'll see shortly. Posterior to this buccopharyngeal fascia, we have some of the deep layers of the deep cervical fascia. We have these alar fascia. That's this light green layer here. This alar fascia is running between the transverse processes of the vertebrae, specifically of the cervical vertebrae. And then we have the prevertebral fascia. And this prevertebral fascia is much more extensive surrounding the vertebrae throughout the neck. But I want us to focus on just this anterior portion of it. And we can see that the prevertebral fascia is investing around not just the vertebral column, but also the deep muscles of the neck as well. Now, thanks to all of these fascial layers, we have some fascial spaces in here. And I'm going to erase some of this so as not to distract from these fascial spaces. The first fascial space that I'd like to point out is going to be between the buccopharyngeal fascia and the alar fascia. So just It'd be that space there. And we refer to that space as the true retropharyngeal space. The true retropharyngeal space is sandwiched between the buccopharyngeal fascia and the alar fascia. And it's called the true retropharyngeal space because it is immediately retro or behind the pharynx. If we go on the other side of the alar fascia, so sandwiched between the alar fascia and the prevertebral fascia here, we have the danger space. That danger space combined with the true retropharyngeal space. So these two together are going to comprise the retropharyngeal space. I know that's a little confusing, but we've got two fascial spaces that come together to form the retropharyngeal space. And I think that this will look a little better when we see this in a sagittal section. So here is our cutout here. And we can make that a little bigger over here. So we will embiggen it. And we can see, so anteriorly here is the buccopharyngeal fascia coming down. And then the alar fascia is behind that, but between the two is that true retropharyngeal space. Behind the alar fascia is the danger space, and then the posterior border of that danger space is the prevertebral fascia as it comes. So up here I've kind of made this even greater of a cartoon. So here is the buccopharyngeal fascia. That buccopharyngeal fascia invests the posterior and the lateral, or I should say the more superficial aspects of the pharyngeal constrictor muscles and, superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle, in that area. But as we move down, we'll get into the middle pharyngeal constrictor muscle. Behind that is our true retropharyngeal space, and the boundary for the true retropharyngeal space and the danger space is the alar fascia. That alar fascia is kind of unique. It goes up to nearly the base of the skull, so up to the first cervical vertebra, up to the atlas, and at about the level of C6, but this is highly variable, can even go down to T4, that alar fascia is going to combine with the buccopharyngeal fascia. So what happens here is that true retropharyngeal space is more of a pocket. And so there's a barrier or an impedance to the movement of any materials that enter that space inferiorly. Whereas if we go posterior to the alar fascia, we're in the danger space, so between the alar fascia and the prevertebral fascia, that danger space is completely contiguous from posterior here all the way down into the superior mediastinum of the thorax. And so this is a theoretical route through which infection can spread, metastases may spread between the neck and the retropharyngeal area down into the thorax. Now I want to discuss ever so briefly the lateral pharyngeal space and its relationship to the retropharyngeal space. And so over here we can see this is our superior pharyngeal constrictor and our middle pharyngeal constrictor. So we know that the retro pharyngeal space is going to be behind this. Well, there's also a lateral pharyngeal space, and the lateral pharyngeal space is conceptualized kind of like an inverted pyramid. So the base of the pyramid is up here, and it comes down to about the hyoid region. And it's not a perfect pyramid, but coming up, and this would be the lateral pharyngeal space. That lateral pharyngeal space is contiguous with the retropharyngeal space, and it gets divided by the styloid process. So here is the stylohyoid ligament coming down that way, and so there's an anterior portion to it and a posterior portion to it. And this lateral pharyngeal space is contiguous with other fascial spaces. In particular, there's a submasseteric space, sometimes just called the masseteric space by clinicians, and there's also a pterygomandibular space. It's really difficult to get a sense for depth here, but I'll just roughly talk through this for those of you that care. For those who don't, you know, you can fast forward through this. But if you can imagine, you know, coming down here onto the mandible would be our masseter, right? That masseter is a robust muscle of mastication. It's very lateral, very superficial. And then deep to that masseter is the ramus of the mandible. But between the ramus of the mandible and the masseter, so this would be the superficial masseter, and then here is our ramus of mandible. So between the masseter and the ramus is that submasseteric space. Deep to the ramus of the mandible is our pterygomandibular space. And that pterygomandibular space is going to be bounded by the medial pterygoid muscle. So we'll learn in the muscles of mastication session that the mandible is really in a muscular sling, with the masseter superficial and the medial pterygoid deep. And so flanking the ramus are going to be these two fascial spaces, the submasseteric space and the pterygomandibular space. These spaces are going to be contiguous anteriorly with the buccal space. And just to kind of clean this out a little, that buccal space is going to be superficial to the buccinator here. We can see there's that pterygomandibular raphae with the buccinator muscle that is anterior to it and the superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle posterior to it. And so we can have the movement of materials from, you know, the face, infraorbital space, buccal space, posteriorly back into these submasseteric and pterygomandibular spaces, which are contiguous with the lateral pharyngeal space, which is contiguous with the retropharyngeal space. So this is a pathway through which materials may move. Which leads us to the assessment question. An infection originating from a periapical abscess of a mandibular second molar could theoretically travel to the thorax via which conduit? Would it be the danger space, the true retropharyngeal space, or the retropharyngeal space? Well, let's think about this. Both A and B together, so the danger space plus the true retropharyngeal space equals the retropharyngeal space. So A plus B equals C. So C is going to be too general an answer. The danger space versus the true retropharyngeal space, let's think about that here. So here's our buccopharyngeal fascia. There is our alar fascia. And there is our prevertebral fascia. So between buccopharyngeal and alar is going to be the true retropharyngeal space. Posterior to alar will be the danger space. And this true retropharyngeal space, if you recall, somewhere around C6 all the way down to T4, blends with the buccopharyngeal fascia to create a pocket. So the potential conduit from the retropharyngeal space is going to be the danger space. And I guess that's probably good that they called it the danger space, because that would be a dangerous pathway. So our correct answer is A, the danger space. Thank you very much for your time.